copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up to the book of Colossians. We're in the fourth chapter this morning. You may have noticed, if you have a man in your house specifically, that the guys aren't quite as chipper as maybe they were the last couple of weeks. Football season has come to a conclusion. Things have changed. We're back into the holding pattern. Almost everybody's team had a good year. We're praying for FSU, but everybody else had a pretty good year. Coach Saban once again has led the Tide to a national championship. Urban Meyer is coming to the Jags. That's a pretty good news. God knows they need it. I don't know what it is about football, but generally it's one of those things that we can all sort of relate to. It's a complicated game in some ways. It's nuanced. It's got a lot of different levels of strategy. But at the same time, it's relatively simple. You want to score more points than the other team. Play by play, you very simply want to get the ball a little bit further down the field. While everyone, every player, you have offensive teams and defensive teams, you have different strategies. But at the same time, all of the players have the same goals in mind. And generally, they're all trying to accomplish the same thing. I think that if the Apostle Paul lived in our culture, in our day, he would say that the Christian life is not altogether that much different. You see, the goal of the Christian life, this side of eternity, is to advance the kingdom. So it's not so much important how much you accumulate, the cars you drive, the land that you possess, the home that you live in, the degrees that you have on your wall. Those things are not anything more than just status symbols. It doesn't show how well you are doing or how successful you are at the Christian life. The Christian life is measured in its success or lack thereof by how much you leverage what you have stewardship over to advance the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And if you're doing that, then all of those other things are just icing on the cake. But the goal is for your family, for your life, for our church to advance the knowledge of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Paul, in our text, he's been teaching through what Luther called the Hausstaffel. It means the household rules or the code of the home. He's been showing how in the home you have different positions that we play. So you may be a dad, you may be a father, you may be a husband, you may be a wife or a mom, you may be a son or a daughter. Those are like positions, like linebacker, quarterback, running back, receiver, whatever it might be. You have these different positions, and as such, you have different ways that you play the game. You have different things you're responsible for. But then there are certain things that we just all share. We're all trying to keep the other team from advancing, and we're all trying to get the ball a little bit further down the field. And we've all got to be operating in the same direction there. So previously, if you haven't been here the last couple of times in this study, we've talked about the different roles in the family. Then we talked about the employer and employee relationship and how the gospel advances through that. Now today, he's going to show what the kingdom advancing life looks like as an overall strategy. So no matter who you are, if you're one of the 130 some odd units that are watching online, if you're here today with us, this applies to every single person in our family of faith this morning. Three things for the kingdom advancing life to be successful. Number one, pray diligently. It is expected that if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, that your life is radically marked by prayer. And I can't overstate that. That is an absolute dominant movement in the Christian life, according to Scripture. When you're studying God's Word, it's helpful to just kind of, to read through it as a whole, but to sort of notice while he may teach certain things here, certain things there, this doctrine, that thought, what are the overarching flavors of the teaching, or what's the main thing that he's trying to communicate? When it comes to prayer, he's not so much concerned about what you say or how you pray, but that prayer is dominant throughout your waking hours, that it's the dominant aspect of your life. It's a big deal, and most of us are not walking in that truth. Look what it says there in verse 2. He says, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. The root word there for continue, when he says, hey guys, every one of you, no matter what position you play in the Christian home, continue in prayer. It's the word katareo in the Greek. And it means to be strong and to be steadfast. But here in the Greek text, he adds a little verb at the beginning of it, the word pros, which amplifies the root word. So if katareo means that you're to be steadfast, that you're to be diligent, you're to be faithful, you're to continue to do this, adding that little verb at the beginning of it amps up the root. So he's saying you should be extremely diligent, that you should be captivated, that you should be haunted, that you should be distracted, that while you want to worship, your worship can't just be singing the songs, but it's literally an engagement of prayer to God. That while you're listening, you're also having a conversation. The Puritans used to not let their audience, their congregation, take notes during the sermon, because they saw it so much receiving the Word of God, the preached Word of God, as an act of worship, that it was to be received and responded to in the moment. It's not just a lecture that you learn, but it's literally part of an ongoing conversation you have with God. Prayer is the dominant aspect of the Christian life. Persistence. In Ephesians 6:18, Paul said it this way. It's sort of an equivalent verse in Ephesians. Colossians and Ephesians are almost overlapping. They're very similar books. He says in verse 18, he says, praying at all times. At all times. Morning, noon, night, good days, bad days. Praying at all times. In the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication, to that end, keep alert with all perseverance, even when it's hard, even when you don't feel like it, making supplication for all the saints. In 1 Thessalonians 5:17, he says, pray without what? Ceasing. Don't ever stop praying. Now, we know that doesn't mean to be verbalizing prayer 24/7 all the time. Kind of be hard to have a conversation with someone doing that, wouldn't it? But it means more than just a general God consciousness. I think for years I thought that it just basically meant just be aware of God. Have your quiet time in the morning. Go through your day just kind of aware that God's there. Call out to Him when you need Him. But it means so much more. This is one of those things God is teaching me in this season of my life. It means more than that. It means to literally have your mind engaged in a conversation with God. It says, Jesus said in Luke 21:36, but keep on the alert at all times, praying. In Acts chapter 6, the early church, it says, gave itself continually to prayer. Romans 12:12, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, be devoted to prayer. Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. This is just different kinds of prayer. Let your requests be made known to God. On the day of Pentecost, when the church was kind of sanctioned and established and sent out, the 120 that were remaining followers of Jesus Christ gathered together in the upper room like we are here. What were they doing? Day and night devoted themselves to prayer. Jesus' teaching, I'm telling you, for years I've overlooked this. So this may just be a sermon for me. Maybe you're passionately devoted to prayer. But this has kind of shaken me this week. He says in Luke 18, Jesus is going to tell a parable, an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. But Luke gave us the meaning of the parable up front. He said, he told them a parable to effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. And he said, basically, he said, there was a woman in a certain city. She was a widow. Now, the widows in Jesus' day were the lowest part of the food chain. They were dependent on the goodness of others. This widow had experienced an injustice. And so she goes to the judge and she says, "Judge, help me out. I need justice in this situation. I've been violated. I've been offended. Will you help me?" And the judge didn't respond. He didn't care what she thought. And she kept going back. Got to work on Monday, there's the widow. Got to work on Tuesday, there's the widow. Got to work on Wednesday, there's the widow. Eventually, the judge said, "Look, I don't care anything about her, but she's going to drive me crazy, so I'm going to help her out." And Jesus said, if this wicked judge would, not because he loved this lady, but because, and not because he's righteous, but because she was bothering him and annoying him, if he would eventually give in and say, "Hey, look, here's what you want. How much more would your heavenly Father do the same thing to you if you will continually seek him?" What's the point? Continually seek him. Continually. I mean, throughout your day, be appearing and appealing before the throne room of God. He tells another parable in Luke 11. He said, if you have a friend that visited at midnight, let's imagine that friend A had a guest who came to see him, and he didn't have anything to feed him. So he gets up and goes over to friend B's house and knocks on the door and says, "Hey, brother, can you get me some bread to give my guest?" The guy inside says, "Look, it's cold. I mean, I know it's Florida, but it's cold." And they didn't have central air and heat, so he said, "We're all bundled up in here asleep, so I can't help you." He says, if that first friend keeps knocking on the door, eventually his buddy's going to get up and say, "Look, dude, I've had enough. Here's the bread." Jesus said, how much more will those who seek find, those who ask receive? He says, keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. God has designed life in Christianity in a way that requires you to perpetually be praying to God. Now again, maybe you get this, but I've always kind of been like this, and I'm confessing this, I guess, to you. I've always kind of looked at it like this. God knows everything, doesn't he? Has it ever occurred to you, nothing's ever occurred to him? Like he knows everything? So he's not saying, "I wonder what's going on in Nassau County today. Zach, how's it going down there?" He knows before I ever utter a word. He knows everything. He is omniscient. He knows everything. So, and he's a loving God. He's all powerful. So sometimes I've sort of looked at it like, well, why do I have to pray all the time? I can just kind of go before God and say, "Well, God, you already know everything that's going on. Just in case you overlooked anything, we have a prayer list at First Baptist. It's on our app. It's here on in printed. We hand it out on Wednesday night at our midweek Bible study. So, Lord, I'm not even going to read it to you. Here it is. I'm sure you read English. So if you don't mind, take care of all of that. In Jesus' name, amen." And almost feeling like that was a sign of my faith. Now, I don't literally do that. But I almost felt like if I just went before God one time and voiced my prayer to him, he's got it. It's in his hands. If he wants to answer it, he'll answer it. If he doesn't, he won't. That, and then you just walk in obedience past that. You're good. And through this study, God is saying to me, no, no, no. That is not the way it works. I've designed life so that you continually have a conversation with me. Why? And so I'm like, why? What? You know what I need before I ask for it. You're either going to do it or you're not. You know what my faith is, you know. So what's the purpose of this ongoing conversation that you're telling me that we need to have? My mind went to Jeremiah 13. Jeremiah 13 is a parable. I encourage you to go read it, but the key verse in that chapter is where God said through the prophet Jeremiah, he said, "As the belt of a man clings to his waist, so I made the whole household of Israel and the household of Judah to cling to me, thus saith the Lord." Now, your belt, if you're wearing a belt today, they're making a comeback, I hear. So if you're wearing a belt today, they are probably, on some of you guys especially, it's the tightest piece of clothing that you're wearing today, or at least it should be. And for some of you, it's quite tight, getting tighter. But it's that way for a reason, and it's been that way for thousands of years. The belt is designed to keep everything where it's supposed to be, keeps everything else together. And so God says in Jeremiah, "I made you to be like a belt on me. You're to be tight, clinging to me. And it will not work any other way." As a matter of fact, in Jeremiah, when they quit clinging to God, God judged the nation. And so your design, at whatever it is you're going through, you say, have you ever said this? What is God trying to say to me through this? He's saying, cling to him. The only way you do that, or the primary way you do that, is through prayer. So you have a friend with COVID. You got a promotion. Your kids are giving you a fit. Your marriage is struggling. What's the point of all that? To get you to cling to your Creator, to get you to latch on to him passionately, consistently, not just to say, well, I checked the box, I had my quiet time. Some of us can't even do that. And God is saying, you are so far from the point. I'm not trying to get you to check a box and jump through a hoop once a day. I'm trying to get you to walk with me through every aspect of your life consistently. I saved you for this purpose. Worship me, walk with me, then work for me. Paul began this whole book of Colossians by saying in chapter 1, verse 3, "We always thank God, the Father of Jesus Christ, when we pray for you." It's the first thing he said. Then he closes it by saying, "You be steadfast in prayer, watchful and thankful." He saturated his ministry with prayer. Well, here's a few practical things just to consider. Do start your day in prayer. Make a plan, have a time to pray. The Bible says over and over and over again, Mark 1:35, speaking of Christ, "And rising very early in the morning while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed." So Jesus, who was God and had the perfect relationship with the Father, started out early in the morning. While it was still dark, he got away from everybody else and he prayed. We read the same of Abraham. We read it of Job. We read it of Jacob, Moses, Hannah, David. Men and women in Scripture that God holds up as examples are people who began their day with prayer. Hudson Taylor said that you do not tune up the instruments once the concert is over. You tune them up at the beginning. It's illogical to do it otherwise. So you began your day, I think of it that way a lot of times, just like an instrument. The guitar has to be in tune with the keyboard, that has to be in tune with the bass, and they're all set to the same frequency, and they're all in tune. So in the same way, at the beginning of my day, I wake up, and I have a time in the morning, I have a cup of coffee. I'm not even sure I'm a Christian until I've had my first cup of coffee. That's just me. But I have a cup of coffee, and as I drink my coffee, I'm going to meet with God, and I'm going to tune my heart to his word. I'm going to get in the word. That's me hearing from God, and then I'm going to pray. That's me speaking to God. So I have a time, first thing in the mornings when I begin. Now, it doesn't end there, but it begins there. Also, I have a place. For me, I have one of these lanais that we have here in Florida, screened-in porches, and I have one of those Cracker Barrel rocking chairs. I've worked my whole life so I could have a Cracker Barrel rocking chair, and I sit out there with my cup of coffee, my Bible, and I meet with God. That's my place. Now, for me, can I be real honest? This place is kind of sacred to me right here, this desk and this room, but not as sacred as that place. That's holy ground for me. That's my place. How many of you, when you moved here, those of you who live here, you got to the beach and you found your spot? And God help anybody who gets your spot. I don't care, but there's people from Georgia who come down and visit here, they can find another spot. I have my spot, right? In the same way, when it comes to your prayer time, you need a spot. You need to find your spot. Jesus had a spot. He had one in each community that he visited, but when he was in Jerusalem, he would go to the mountain. We have five times where the scriptures say that Jesus departed to the mountain to pray. When he got to the mountain, there was a certain area that was owned by a wealthy landowner, and it was there on the Mount of Olives, and it was the place of the olive press. They would gather all the olives together, they would press them and make olive oil. And he would go to that same spot every single day, and he would go to his friend's property, and he would pray. It was called Gethsemane. It's no wonder when Jesus is preparing to face the most difficult challenge, when literally he will absorb the wrath of his Father on our behalf, he's going to go to the place he went every single day of his life when he was in Jerusalem. He walked up that mountain, he went into the olive press, to his place that to him was like the temple, and he prayed to his Father. Do you have a place? Do you have a time? Start in the morning, get up, go to your spot. For my wife, it's in her office. She's got a little place in her office that she likes to pray. For me, it's on that back porch. Do you have a place? A regular place to go and meet with your Father that for you is like holy ground. Then have a plan. You'll see that the prayers of Scripture kind of follow a pattern. I use what I call it's been given to me, but the ACTS prayer method, A-C-T-S, Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, and Supplication. When you got your bulletin this morning, there were some of those laying out there. If you didn't get one coming in, get one going out. But it's just a little guide. It's there to help you. It's not a legalistic thing, but you can use it if it helps. But it just gives you a plan. So when I go to my place, my time, I'm meeting with God, I begin with adoration. It's like worship. In nature, there's always something that reminds you, God, I thank you for the sunrise. This is the day that you made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I hear a sparrow in a tree. Lord, thank you. Not a single sparrow falls to the ground without your attention. And they don't stress out. They're not on anxiety medication. They're not stressed. And you take care of them. I thank you that this person that you've made, that you knit together in his mother's womb, is worth far more than they are. And if you look after them, how much more will you look after me? That's adoration. I'm just adoring God. Then confession. Father, there's some things that I shouldn't have done. Thoughts I shouldn't have thought. Things I shouldn't have said. Attitudes that were amiss. Motivations that were wrong. Forgive me. I plead the blood of Jesus Christ that he died for those sins, and I ask you to forgive me for what I did. And Lord, after I confess everything I know of, Lord, if there's anything that I know there's still other things that probably in my heart that were wrong, and I confess my unknown sins as well. And Father, thank you that your grace is sufficient and that you cover all of my sins. So I just go through A-C-T-S, then supplication. I ask God for things. That's what it means. Pray for others. The guide walks you through all of that. Now, there's other things in my prayer ritual that that I've added to it over the years. I picked up the prayer of Jabez in college. I've prayed that literally every day of my life with very few exceptions for many, many years. It's just been a ritual in my life. The Shema, a Jewish prayer, I've prayed that many, many years, almost every day of my life. And those are just things that are patterns for me. Now, I think of them like running bases. I get there, I may not be fully awake yet, got my coffee, I'm working on it, fresh air, and I began to pray, and I think of it like first base, second base, third base, home. So adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. So I think of it like that, and I pray through my prayer guide. Now, there are times when you get to your spot, you have your time and your place, you get there, but something is so heavy on your heart and it's dominating your thoughts that you're like, man, I want to pray for my church. I want to pray for my nation. God knows we need it. I want to pray for all these things. But my mother-in-law is in intensive care right now. I'm not joking. She really is right now. And so sometimes you get to your prayer time and that's just there. And you could go and pray and go through the ritual, but man, that's on. So here's what I've learned to do. I've learned to assume that God put it there. This that is so heavy on my heart, maybe He wants to talk to me about that. And so I continue to use my guide, but I filter this situation through the prayer guide. So I'll say, Lord, my mother-in-law, my father-in-law, they're in the hospital. I just got to thank you that you made them. Every fiber of their being, every cell of their body, you put it there. You are the great physician who knows perfectly how to heal them of their sickness. I confess to you, going to the next base, confess to you that sometimes I worry and I get anxious about these kind of things. And I know it's wrong that we should cast all of our care upon you, for you care for us. And then thanksgiving, I thank you that you are a perfect, powerful, all-knowing, sovereign, providential God. Now, I ask you, would you bring healing into their life? You see what I mean? So if I don't know what to pray, I have the guide. If I have something dominant in my life, I still filter through the guide. That's how I do it. So I have a plan. Then letter D, develop prayer as the knee-jerk reaction to everything. You lose a child, pray. You lose your keys, pray. You lose your temper, pray. Do you see how it works? Everything. The biggest circumstances in life, there's nothing that you look at and go, well, that God doesn't care about that. That's not a big deal. Pray about everything. These kids on the front, I've got two of my kids here. One's in college. I remember, I'm a communicator, so I like to talk, but I remember when my first one was born and we got her home and I was so excited to get to know her and she didn't say anything. Not a word. I mean, she would scream is all she could do. And I remember feeling like I just wasn't a very good dad. You know, I tried. I did all I could. I helped out, but I just didn't feel like a very good dad. And then now she's a college student, and we talk through, you know, worldview. We talk through all sorts, politics, you know, we talk through, and that conversation, I feel like this is how God, as a dad, this is what God made me for. It's for my kids as college students. So Caitlin, if I'm not great right now, give it a few years. I'm really awesome in a few years, but that, you know, but it's about the communication. It's about the talk. And sometimes God just wants to talk to you. He wants you to cling to Him and love Him and be engaged in a conversation with Him. Make it the knee-jerk reaction to everything in life. Everything you do, have a dialogue with God going on. Number two. So you pray diligently, speak the gospel with clarity. Look at verse 3. He says, at the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Speak with clarity in regards to the gospel. If you have been here for 3 years and you cannot clearly convey the gospel, how to get saved, to another individual, we have failed you terribly. That's the primary goal of every ministry of this church, is to equip you to convey the gospel to the people that are in your circle of influence. The primary reason we're here. I mean, think about it. Everything else we do, you'll do better in heaven. You'll sing better, you'll pray better, you'll serve better. Whatever you do, you'll do better in heaven. The only thing that you cannot do in heaven is win somebody to Jesus. There's no lost people there. So God saved you and left you as a missionary and a representative for Him. So pray you do it well. Do it with clarity. Be clear. I remember in the 90s, I was a college student, hadn't been saved that long, and I was watching back when Larry King was on. I used to watch Larry King almost every weeknight, and it was one of his interviews with a famous evangelist, a televangelist. And Larry asked him one day, he said, what does it take for a person to go to heaven? And this televangelist said, well, Larry, I think everybody kind of gets there their own way. This guy's supposed to be a Christian. And I remember just being devastated that he had this opportunity. It was just teed up for him. It was right there and ready. And he just swung and missed. And I asked one of my buddies, I said, how does that happen? I mean, how do you get it that wrong? And my friend said, you don't. You don't. If this is the primary thing that we're about, and if you fall out of bed at 2:00 in the morning, you ought to be able to articulate the gospel before you hit the floor. It's the primary thing that we're about. So if somebody comes up to you and says, hey, how do I get saved? And you say, well, you got to get baptized. Wrong. We failed if that's the case. The primary to communicate, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, Jesus has died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried and he was raised again on the third day. This is the gospel I've preached to you, is it not? And to communicate that and to articulate it with clarity is what it's all about, man. And so if you convey a different gospel, well-meaning though it may be, we have failed. So to communicate with gospel clarity is essential. You want to get the ball further down the field. You want to advance the kingdom. Learn how to convey the gospel. Be able to share the gospel with your kids. Be able to share the gospel with your parents. Be able to share the gospel with your circle of influence, whoever that may be. And articulate it clearly as you have the opportunity. Number three, live wisely. He says in verse 5, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Now notice that word time. I'm going to come back to that. He elaborates in verse 6. He says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. So he mentions how you walk and how you talk. You're to do both with wisdom. Suppose today I came in and I said, church, I have some really good news. I have an inside track and I have thousands of doses of the COVID vaccine. As a matter of fact, I took one yesterday and we're going to be giving them at the end of today's service to all of you. And then I started coughing and I fell over dead. Would you take my vaccine? You'd think, something didn't work. I'm gonna let somebody else go first, right? So you have to, if you say you know Christ and the Holy Spirit walks in your heart and you have a relationship with God, you should be able to show that through your life, shouldn't you? St. Francis of Assisi, I think is who it was credited to, that said, preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words. It's necessary to use words. Listen to me very carefully. Nobody gets saved by seeing your good behavior alone. They must see your good behavior. They must see that you live wisely. But if you don't articulate the gospel clearly, Salvation happens as the mind receives the truth claims of Christ and believes them. That's how salvation happens. It is not just a mental assent. It's not just a mental exercise, but it is not less than that. If you say, well, Pastor, when I got saved, I didn't understand anything about the cross or resurrection or anything. You need to go look at it. I'm not saying you're lost. I'm just saying that may not have been your conversion experience. Jesus said that if a person receives the word of the kingdom and doesn't understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. Look it up. It's very important that you hear it, you understand it, you receive it and believe it. That's how you come to Christ. So you must use words. No one looks at you and goes, man, I've been watching you for a long time. You don't kick your dog. You don't cuss your wife. I've come to the conclusion that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He died on the cross, was raised from the dead on the third day. Nobody comes to that conclusion just by watching you not cuss your wife or kick your dog. You've got to explain that. Now, if you explain, you can go preach the gospel every day of your life. You're kicking your dog and cussing your wife, they're going to be suspect. Right? It's two wings to the same plane. The life has to be there, but you have to convey the gospel. You have to speak the truth. My biggest fear as a pastor is not that we're going to pick wrong music or that we're not going to be cool enough or any of that stuff. My biggest fear as a pastor is that somehow we will become so introverted as a church that we begin to think that it's about us. And we begin to do this so that we can learn something new and feel better about ourselves. And we can read a new book. I'm so tired of seeing people go from class to class to class, Bible studies, they get spiritually bloated, and they get muscle-bound, and they're good for nothing. I want you to go to your neighborhood and realize you are the chaplain of your neighborhood. You're there for a reason. God has used you in your circle of influence, your oikos, your people, to lead them back to a knowledge of Jesus Christ. He says here, redeeming the time. In the Greek, time is used two ways. You have the word chronos. That means time that can be measured. We're coming up on the hour. It's almost 11:30 in Eastern. That's chronos time. Chronology comes from chronos. Then there's the word kairos. That means a moment of time, an opportunity is the best way to think of it. In this text, he's using the word kairos. He says, redeem the opportunity. Learn to look at every interaction with another human being as a potential opportunity. Doesn't mean that every interaction you've got to convey the gospel, but you will either till the soil, get the ball a little bit further down the court or down the field, or you'll surrender ground with every interaction with a human being. You go to a restaurant, they come out and they serve you. The order's not exactly the way that you want it. There's a way that you can communicate that with class and with gentleness and say, well, you know, I wanted it cooked a little bit more or whatever it might be. Or you can just pitch a fit and take that kairos opportunity to nudge that waitress a little bit closer to hell. When you post online, every post is a kairos moment. Every post is a kairos moment. It's an opportunity that with it, you can redeem the moment. You can nudge the ball a little bit further down the field. Or you can nudge people a little bit closer to hell. It is wise to ask the question, what effect will this post have every time you post? Will it help people know Jesus? Or will it at least convey the truth? Will it convey something that is salvific, that is redemptive? Or will it nudge people away from their Savior? Every single time. You don't have the right as a Christian, even though you might legally have the right as a citizen, you do not have the right as a Christian to be unkind. Use the moment. And remember, you're here to win the game. You're here to win the world. Several years ago, over 20 years ago, John Piper said these words to his church, and I'll close with this. He says, from time to time in the life of the church, there needs to be a wake-up call to some simple, central, and basic things. One of these is, Christianity is a converting religion. It is evangelistic. It is persuasive and expansive and missionary. It is not coercive. It doesn't use the sword or manipulation or brainwashing to advance. But it does proclaim and persuade and plead and pray. When we lose a passion to see other people won over to Jesus, we lose Jesus. Christianity is a soul-winning, outreaching, mind-persuading, heart-entreating, rescuing, missionary faith, or it is not true Christianity. We need to be reminded of this because it is almost incredible how listless we can become calling ourselves Christians. Little by little, our whole orientation can become inward. We just go about our in-house religious business like a medical clinic that sees fewer and fewer patients and has more and more staff meetings until there is nothing left but a smooth-running program for the doctors and the nurses and their families. This is what happens to many churches, and we need to hear this. We're at the beginning of the year. We've got, God willing, 11 more months in front of us. I don't know what's going to happen with the government. I don't know what's going to happen with COVID. But I can tell you that the purpose of First Baptist Church ought to be that if anyone in Nassau County dies and goes to hell or in the surrounding region, they will have to go over us to get there. Let's pray. At this time in our service, our musicians are coming and getting ready to lead us in a hymn of invitation. We call it the invitation because we invite you to respond. Many of us can respond in our seats privately just by talking to God and saying, Dear Lord, I know I need to pray more. I know I need to be reminded to win people. I should be inviting. I should be reaching. But then there are others, there are times when there's just the necessity to make a public decision. Sometimes people come and they pray here at the stage just because this is a place that's sacred to them and they want to pray here. You're welcome to do that. At times, people say, you know what, I want to be an official part of this family of faith because God designed His church that we really reach the world as a team. And we need first string, second string, third string. We need quarterbacks. We need wide receivers. We need linebackers. So whatever position you play, I'm recruiting. We could use you. If you sense the Holy Spirit is nudging you to say, you really ought to unite with this church, then our coaches are here. They're going to be down here at the front, and they're ready to sign you up. Some of you today, you've been in the stands your whole life. You've never got in the game. Maybe today you need to put down the drink, put down the popcorn, and say, I'm going to give whatever God gives me, if it's another day or another decade. I'm going to give it to furthering the kingdom. Perhaps you're here and you've never been saved. You feel the burden of your sin. You feel guilt. And maybe you haven't done some horrible, awful thing that we read about and hear about, but you know you're a sinner. You didn't need a preacher to tell you that. You know you're a sinner. And you would love to know the forgiveness and the peace that God promises. Then in just a moment, when I say amen, I want to ask you to step out and come and take one of these guys by the hand and just say, I need to be saved. It will be their joy to walk you through that. I'm going to pray for you. As I pray, you pray. Pray for those around you and decide if God is calling you to make a decision. Our Father, we bow before you, thanking you so much that you love us enough to get us out of our comfort zone, to challenge us, to motivate us, to reprove us, so that this day and every day after, we might cling to you the way a belt clings to a man. And oh God, if this body, if just a fraction of these people take hold of you and walk with you in that way, I can only imagine how it would impact this community, this region, this world. Speak to us, Lord. We're listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet.